Welcome back to the Content Complete podcast, featuring myself, Spencer, and my friend Matt of Neanderthal Gaming TV, and Super Fistcake. May we remember him as he has ascended to the alien gods and has been risen and provided his new second form.
Easter is about me.
Oh, solid.
Thank you. I'm only just delivering the layup as Spencer hands me the ball.
Absolutely.
A layup is a thing in basketball. I don't know if you guys watch sports or anything ever, but...
Dude, I used to play sports.
All of them?
In fourth grade, I was on the basketball team. If I know what a layup is.
If I look at sports, I get tired and sore.
I get frustrated.
Also, layups were like the only thing I could do.
Oh, well, hey, there we
short.
Go.
I played point, basically.
You're very short.
Okay, now you're getting too complicated for me. Point?
What yeah, that? Point guard. Click? I was the guy who just like prevented other people from getting to the basket.
Hey, is my mic like way quieter than yours?
I can check it real quick. All right, fill for time. Fistcake, what are we talking about?
Well, today we are talking about numerous things, such as G2A's response to Gearbox's response to G2A. We got little things from Nintendo Direct. We're going to talk about the new PC port for Bayonetta. Maybe talk about some Yooka-Laylee stuff. Maybe talk about that de novo thing getting totally fucked up. And, you know, a bunch of other fun stuff.
Sick.
And SEO tips by Neanderthal Gaming TV.
Boom, 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 boom.
That's the tip.
Perfect.
Yeah. Hope you
at
can
the beginning
decipher
of your
it.
Video, boom, 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 increases revenue by at least 1%.
Yeah, actually, Google
had to tag it
takes too. A look at it, and they scan it with their translation machine.
Mm.
And they put that shit, and they just raise it. The more boom, boom, booms, the higher it goes.
Mm-hmm. Now, for every 1,000 like, boom boom booms, you get an extra cent.
Oh. So do you tag boom 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 boom, or do you just tag three different booms?
You see that part, it's debated. It's mm-hmm. debated. They haven't really released that information. Mm-hmm. So you have to play around, figure out which works best for you.
Those assholes.
Fucking we computers. Go over what we've been playing this week. Want to start with you, Mr. Fistcake-a-rooney?
Fistcake-a-rooney really and cheese.
Never say that again.
Mr. Fistcake-a-rooney.
Okay. That never happened. Let's see. What did I play this week? I finished off Resident Evil 7 during my stream. And the fun part of that was I played Monday, Wednesday. And I thought I would have like another hour of content on Friday. I'm like, oh, I'll play this for a little bit. Then I'll finish off with some Dragon's Dogma.
Mm-hmm.
I finished the game in 15 minutes on Friday. I'm like, oh, well, shit, that's a lot quicker than I thought it would be. So I played Dragon's Dogma for a good hour.
What do you think of that?
Oh, I love it. It's a lot better than what I first bought for the Xbox 360 like many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And it was okay then. Like, it was still fun. It's just like now playing the Dark Arisen one where it's also for the PC and it's also like updated with like faster load times and smoother animations and shit. It's like, oh, this is perfect.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of people really enjoy the updated version of it, and I think there's a lot of people like you who are like, man, this game feels like it, you know, it could be good, but this is not something that I'm really enjoying. And then coming back to it, they're like, wow, no, this game actually is good. Which I feel like the game could have a bigger player base if it wasn't for that. On PC, at least, with the new release.
Oh, I think they did a good job.
Yeah, no, they did. Yeah, they did a good job. I was just saying the initial issues with the original version, I feel like it's harder to get people to be like, no, we fixed it. You should really look into this now. You know what I'm saying?
No, really, I promise. It's good. Yeah, I'm trying to think. Yeah, it was iffy at best when it first started out, but then this time, this new one's like, oh, well, I'm going to play the shit out of it.
What are you? Course, what class are you playing?
All right, now I'm playing as a warrior, but I'm gonna max everything out. Of course, I mean, get all those augments or whatever. Get all those special skills.
Yeah, the game. I really love the system that they use for just expanding on the characters and leveling up, and just the way that they go about that, and the buddy like the party member system is really really cool too as well.
Yeah.
You can make your own little buddy. Time.
Yeah.
Your own little friend.
Who do we have? We have Roy.
Roy.
Roy. We gave him the deepest voice we could. It's so funny. You can't even hear what he says. It's just like, whoa, 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 whoa.
It's like dubstep when he talks.
It's great.
Be careful, Rason.
That's basically it. Oh my god. And then the whole first area where, like, literally they just talk about how fire is useful against the wolves. Just every moment that they have a chance, like, oh, did you know that fire is good against the wolves? And they just say that in five different ways.
Oh, yeah. Tis weak against fire.
Yeah, tis weak against fire. It's like, oh god. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, you told me that the first three times. Now, my pawn is the cousin. Or no, she's technically the daughter of the one that I made in the first one, in the original Dragon's Dogma. It's a
You got to export your thingy, or
no, I had
no. He has his own cannon.
Oh. I have my own cannon.
Oh, okay.
Follow along, Jesus Christ,
man! I'm dropping the ball.
Don't bring God into this on this holy day.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Shit, sorry God.
Sorry God.
sorry God.
My bad, bro.
Keep it real.
My bad. But no, the name is Boo B. Z, the fifth. She's the fifth one, and the one before her was the fourth. Which, if you just say it out loud, it's boobs. It's just it's nothing.
I had a feeling
cool
it was
clever.
Boobs.
It was boobs, yeah.
I couldn't put together the text that you provided me into my mind. But
it's just boobs. That's nice. All it was. That was very clever. I thought of it. I'm like,
I'm a genius.
I think I tried to just like put out like just boobs originally. I'm like, I'll put boobs a fourth. Why not? And then it says like, you can't put that in here. I'm like, oh, I guess I'll have to be more careful about that. And then
Boombox, we streamed last Sunday at the same exact time.
Yeah, we're doing this every week now.
Every Sunday, 5 p.m. Central to 6-ish p.m. Central. Be there or be a box.
3 o'clock our time.
You're here now, and that's great. But as far as last time we streamed, I don't know if you watched us like in the past. But
Boombox, I feel like he gave you tips on Ganondorf.
He might have. But yeah, I mean, there was like a 6-month period where we didn't stream.
Hey, Littlefinger, what's going on? Our man.
Or woman.
We still don't know. Shit, that's still a mystery. But yeah. Let's see. Play those games. I played some D&D last night with some friends and family.
Oh,
nice. Good shit. Yeah. That's fun.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We actually have a campaign going on right now with our friends as well.
Nice. And that's always kind of fun. Like before, when I played with my friends, I was playing with my girlfriend's brother's friends, and the DM for them was doing a pretty good job. It's just that before I always had like bad experiences because it was just really boring when other people did it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But this guy, he made like a really good, he did a really good job of like keeping me in like, hey, you're all doing this. And there was like a fight like every 10 minutes. And it was pretty cool. It was just good times.
Yeah. But, really, it makes a difference whether whoever is DMing or jamming or whatever you want to call it, make sure to include people and, you know, give people moments and all that type of stuff. It's honestly like the whole only reason why people play is so that they can have a spotlight of some type and kill things, of course, and get loot.
Hey, how's it going, Teddy Bear McCoy? Has anyone ever tried voice acting? Well, it's funny you should mention that.
If you watch our Hollow Knight series
oh, boy.
On the NFL Gaming TV on YouTube, I do a bit of voice acting myself. I have always wanted to actually voice act.
I'm annoyed by it, so...
Matt's not annoyed by it.
He loves it secretly, right, Matt?
Mm.
Right. Oh, God, no. Now, I had a brief stint with voice acting, just doing freelance stuff, and I kind of do voice acting for my other podcast, but...
Yeah, it's
not too hard. I just use my default voice. I do an alien, I do a regular guy, and for my alien, I just deepen my pitch by 25%. That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's pretty fun. I enjoy it.
I mean, it's always a tradition for myself that anytime there's a game that just has text and there's no in-game voice acting, that I have to provide the voice. It's something I just have to do.
It's one of your rules. It's like God put that into his DNA while he was being made.
They're like, there will be this thing called video of the games. You will want to and have this urge to voice act.
You must act out everything. Oh, I think I misspelled that. Let me double check if that works.
Casting call.
But I forgot a G. Hold on.
Casting call club.
One G really tripped you up that bad, Spencer?
Oh, the lack of the G is what really messed me up. Like Cast and Call Club? Cast and Call Club.
I was like, yeah, Cast and Call Club.
Well, it's also hard for me to see because it's like way over there.
Excuses.
Yeah.
Pathetic. But that's what I played this week. I think I'm going to start playing Lisa or play emulate a PlayStation 2 game. I'm not for sure, but I think I'm going to go with Lisa because it looks really interesting.
Yeah, and, we need to play that as well.
Yeah, we should stream together sometime. Not this weekend because I'll be dead for the weekend.
Thanks for the follow there, Teddy Bear.
Teddy Bear McCord coming in with the follows. Yeah, having a mic is the more important thing of doing voice acting. And Spencer has tips about soundproofing your area and
audio guru
mics and stuff. Yeah, so if you ever want to hit him up, I'm sure he would be happy to chat through that.
Yeah, our official channel Twitter is Neanderthal GTV on Twitter, but I have one and it's NGTV Suspense, SUSPENSE. And I can talk about that stuff all the time. But as far as what we played, was that basically what you had done as far as games you played this week?
Now back to you with the news of what you played this week. Stuff.
I played and beat a game called Steam World Dig.
Oh, that game was actually pretty good.
Yeah, I think I've seen that.
It's basically like a light Metroidvania.
Okay.
A lot of digging that you do. Mm-hmm. And what was interesting to me, because I wasn't playing the game, mm-hmm. was the fact that there isn't a clear, necessarily bad guy or main antagonist mm-hmm. that you really face, but there's still this weird kind of pushing power for you to just continue to play the game because of the mechanics and mm-hmm. the other things that it provides.
It's really fun.
Yeah, it's actually a pretty relaxed kind of just fun game to play, well, at least watch.
How long did it take you to beat it?
3 hours.
3 hours.
It's pretty short.
Oh, okay, so a nice little weekend game or something. Mm-hmm.
Which is great because I didn't really know about the games before, but it's actually a series, and they're coming out with a second edition of it that's coming out on the Switch here soon. So, that's funny. They're like, I just found out about this, and turns out they're making more. So
how convenient, using their first game as a trailer for their second game.
Classic.
Classic
capitalism.
Capitalism. That's some deep capitalism. You got to make a whole game just to advertise the second one.
And that's basically capitalism. What Star Wars Battlefront 1 was.
Yeah, it's true. The new one. Oh, that is actually because Star Wars Battlefront 2 looks like so much more of a game.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I've seen a little bit of it, the new trailer, but yeah.
And then I played and beat DMC, Devil May Cry, the new one with the edgy new Dante. And I liked it a lot.
How'd you like that?
I liked it, because I never played any DMC before.
And, oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, then
I was totally brand new to the whole series. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was good. It had really fun combat, and it was like, I don't know. I kind of like really bad, edgy,
cocky
people like that. I don't know why. Mm.
Yeah, Matt.
I try to model myself after them.
All of Matt's favorite characters are just the super cocky, like I don't give a fuck about anyone type characters.
Yeah. So this new Dante was, right up my alley.
Although honestly, you went in and played a little bit of DMC3 as well.
Yeah. So I was
old Dante. Segueing. Yeah, it's pretty much the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah. So then I went back and started playing DMC3, and it's like I don't understand why everybody was so pissed off about the tone and everything like that, because I played like an hour, maybe an hour and a half, and it seems like the same kind of tone, like goofy, like over the top.
Yeah, the entire intro is this incredibly ridiculous sequence involving a pool table, and he shoots all the balls that end up flying into the air and then hits the cue ball into the other balls and then takes a bunch of guys out in this random slow-mo sequence.
Yeah, and he's like eating pizza.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I was like, hey, the only difference here is that the other Dante had like short hair.
I think that's pretty much, I think it's just people didn't like the fact that he was like an edgy teenager type versus like an old veteran, not old veteran, but like a seasoned demon hunter.
That's true. Yeah.
You should play the first one. That was hilarious because I think the intro is for the first one is like he's at the same place, but he's older.
Oh,
than he...
I did actually. I have downloaded the ISO for that.
Oh, nice. Okay.
And got like I got the PS2 emulator all set up and did it. Mm-hmm. And then that intro was just as goofy as everything else.
Yeah, because like, doesn't she the lady like drives a car or drives a motorcycle?
Drives a motorcycle like into the building.
Yeah,
and he's like,
"Oh shit,
the bathroom's in the back." And you're like, "Ah, oh, same old Dante."
Oh, Dante, you little rascal.
What's interesting about that is that I, through my research of trying to find out which Dante or not Dante, which Devil May Cry I should play after the new one.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the original Devil May Cry was originally supposed to be Resident Evil 4.
That's what I heard.
Yeah, that's surprising.
Yeah.
I can't imagine Resident Evil being a spectacle fighter.
Yeah.
It's almost like when Metal Gear Solid, they came out with that version of Metal Gear that is a spectacle fighter.
Revengeance or...
Yeah, something like that.
Oh, yeah, Metal Gear Rising, yeah.
Yeah, Rising. That was also like, oh, that's... Okay. Cool.
Do you know about Metal Gear Acid?
No.
No? Oh, it's a series they made for the PlayStation portable games, and it was a turn/card based game where basically you can walk around in squares and stuff, and you had to use cards to use attacks or sneak around or shit.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, I never played it, but as soon as I heard of it, I'm like, that sounds really stupid, but
yeah,
I mean,
it sounds like one of those where it's really relaxed gameplay, probably slow. If you're not into it, it could be boring because I mean, are you walking on these tiles? Is that the whole game or is that just for combat?
I think I'm not for sure. I had to like check it out again.
Because if that's the whole game, then Jesus, are they trying to make an old style roguelike out of it now? It's like,
yeah, I have no idea, but I saw that like when I first see it, I was like a kid or something. I was like, oh, this looks stupid. I'm never gonna get this ever.
Mm-hmm.
Metal Gear Rising, I thought was badass because like in the whole Metal Gear story, the point where Raiden's actually a cool character, you don't get to play as him. It's like, oh, he becomes a badass after the fact that he's in a different game. And you don't get to play as him.
Yeah,
and I feel like this is like their version of like, oh, let's bring him in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's pretty fun. Yeah,
I mean,
it looked cool.
I was just kind of like surprised by it.
Oh, it's fun. Yeah, I feel like that kind of action games of over the ridiculousness of those action games, and yeah, because your first boss fight, you're fighting a Metal Gear, and you're like cutting it up like directly in half, and I think you actually like pick it up at one point and like throw it around.
Yeah, it seems like all these spectacle fighters are real goofy.
Yeah,
they're just like super over the top.
I think it's because it's, well, that's from made by Platinum Games, who also makes Bayonetta.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so I think that's just like that's just their niche because they also did stuff with that with like the wonderful 101, where like the cutscene QTE battles were over the fucking top. So.
Yeah. And
actually, Matt ended up playing Bayonetta.
Yeah. I decided.
Back to that later.
Well, I played it though.
Oh yeah, I mean, yeah. I was just saying.
He wants to move on to topics.
Okay, that's fine.
No, yeah. I wasn't talking about that. I was just saying save that for the we're talking about and the topics.
I got you.
Yeah, you got me. You feeling me, fam?
Yeah,
you got me.
100.
I'm always feeling you, man.
Okay.
Oh Jesus! It's coming from inside the house.
And I think that pretty much wraps it up.
Oh really?
For what I played.
Yeah.
And, I had like 20 hours in Bayonetta.
I can't think, I don't think I played anything extra this week. I had kind of like a weird week of like work, so coming home it was just like, I'm just going to chill.
Yeah.
Just going to chill. But I've been meaning to play a bunch of games. I have, what is it, Total Warhammer?
Mm-hmm.
And I've been so...
Total War Warhammer.
Yeah, Total War Warhammer. And I've been so like wanting to play that, and I played only maybe a couple of hours of it. And they're coming out with the second one soon, so I want to it kind of is in the same storyline in a way. They kind of connect, so I want to play through this one so I can get to the second one, but I haven't had the chance to. That game is
due time.
Yeah. Okay, so if you want to, Super Fist Cake, do you want to go into the response that G2A provided?
Oh, absolutely.
Gearbox, which is what we talked about last week.
So, yeah, if I remember correctly from last week's episode on Content Complete, we were talking about how G2A, or how Gearbox basically made an official statement with Total Biscuit demanding illicit demands from G2A. And on April 9th, G2A made an official statement about it, basically saying, like, oh, those things you asked for? Yeah, no, we already do those. Whatever.
We're not going to make any changes because you basically asked us to do what we already do, which is, like, they really skirted around the issue.
Yeah, they really didn't, like, kind of tackle anything at all. They're just like, yeah, we already do those things, so we're not going to do anything new. Here's the reason why, or here's the, like, they gave examples for how to, like, kind of circumvent problems with G2A Shield or whatever, and all the transparency and all that hidden fees and stuff.
We're on Reddit, and they had a link of how to unsubscribe from G2A Shield.
Oh, yeah, let me go into that. So this guy was talking about how he was like, hey, if you were at all convinced by this response that G2A isn't, in some way, like, totally shitty, then look at this link. And this guy had his imager album of each step that it took for you to just to unsubscribe from G2A Shield. And it goes in, and it starts out, it's just a normal thing. You're like, yes, I'd like to do it. And they're like, okay, are you sure? And you're like, yes. And it goes, takes you to another screen. And then it's like, okay, well, if you stick with us, then we'll provide it to you 50% off. You know, we'll give you 50% off if you stick with us. And they're like, no, I don't want to do that. Like, okay, if you stick with us, then we'll give you this other thing. They start offering you some more stuff. And then you have to say, you know, okay, no, I don't want to do that. And the button to say no.
Yeah, all these buttons that say no are so much smaller.
It's basically just link text. And then the button to say, I'd rather keep Shield is like this huge blue button.
It's green.
Is it green? Okay, I didn't remember.
Oh, wow.
But so it goes on. And there's, I think, 12 or 13 steps, and it involves you have to give them your card number that's attached to G2A Shield to confirm that you want to do it. You have to put in your email address. They send you an email confirmation. You then have to click the confirmation again, and then it takes you back to the thing. They still try to convince you to stick with them. It's this huge, long process, and you finally unsubscribe, and they're like, okay, it should take up to 20 minutes to process, and you'll get another email, and then you can confirm it at this point. And it took exactly 20 minutes for this guy to get it back, and then finally confirmed. And it doesn't.
They're milking every minute,
and you don't unsubscribe until you go through that email that they have to give to you, and then actually confirm it there. Otherwise, you're not unsubscribed until that happens. So people were talking about how that's a tactic to get people to maybe forget about you know, about it, make it take a long time so people aren't paying attention, and then they just never get back to their email to actually officially unsubscribe, because that is a tactic
so
that is used.
Shady and underhanded.
It's annoying, and just they make it as hard as possible so that people okay, whatever, fine, I'll just keep it, you know?
You should definitely put that on the channel or the notes for the episode.
I'll try to remember to include that, because I know I had to go back and add all the links that we talked about last time to the episode twos.
Let me message you this link, because Total Biscuit, he didn't really say anything about the G2A statement, but he just basically retweeted an article from Tech Raptor, which I'll give you this link, and then I'll put it on the chat. Or basically this what's his name, Andrew Auten, basically goes through the entire G2A statement and has like evidence and stuff of why everything they say is wrong and how hard it is to, like you said, how to get away from a Shield subscription and like how shitty the Shield or how shitty it is to make people pay for fraud protection.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
on a site that deals 90% in fraud.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Like how, like, basically a fundamental thing that's provided for literally customers on every other business in the entire existence of history.
Yeah.
They make you pay for it. It's like, oh, well, yeah, pay for protection, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What's crazy
racketeering.
Yeah. The term for that is racketeering, definitely. And that link, I mean, that's itemized. They go through every statement and then take it apart as they go. So that's actually looks like a really, really good article.
Oh, and yeah, they also linked to a thing where how easy it is to scam, because it's like they were talking about how hard it would be for to get your money refunded back if the person that originally sold you the key just disappeared.
Yeah, which is obviously going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's they have an article some Kotaku article about how they talked to one scammer who's like, yeah, no, this is the easiest thing in the world. You just hack a credit card, you buy a bunch of keys, you sell them, and then you just delete your email account and all that fun stuff. It's like, oh, well, Jesus.
Please do not buy from G2A.
Yeah, you're going to get scammed at least 7 times out of 10. And
it's just not worth it.
Yeah, it's not worth it. It's more ethical to pirate than it is to buy from G2A.
Which is sad.
Yeah.
It is sad.
But yeah, including that issue, they also have a list of like all the people that they've dealt with over the years, which are the most recent one besides Gearbox was Tiny Build.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ubisoft had to deactivate a bunch of keys on G2A.
Yeah, I read about that, where basically they straight up just deactivated them on their side or something like that because they couldn't get them to do it over there.
Yeah, they couldn't. Yeah, and then Devolver Digital did the same thing. The Elder Scrolls Online, Natural Selection 2, which who cares about that? Kinguin, Indie Game Stand, Tryon Worlds. I'm not for sure what they do.
Tryon Worlds does Rift, and there's like an MMO.
Yeah, oh,
MMO. They do a couple other things, but Rift is their main thing, which is kind of like a WoW clone.
Ah, my man, coming in with the knowledge. We got the Worlds of Magic, Wastelands Interactive. They did the same thing. Where actually their thing was a little bit more unique. They ran into an issue where people posed as YouTubers in emails to request keys for previews.
Yeah.
Jim Sterling was talking about how prevalent that's becoming.
Yeah, and they'll pose as like people like Jim Sterling and Total Biscuit and stuff like that. And
like, I have so many fucking viewers, give me a free key and then I'll sell it.
Yeah. And in the past, I mean, Matt and I have done the whole ask for a review copy to do reviews. But
we did it as ourselves.
Yeah, we did it as ourselves, and we gave accurate numbers. And most you know, respectable indie companies, unless they have a specific thing against it, will work with you like that. And then you just have a reputation, basically, where if you don't end up doing anything with it or don't go through with your promise to make like a review video or a first impressions video, then there's a thing that goes along with that. So
yeah, it's actually frowned upon.
Yeah, it sucks because it's like, man, these people are just getting away with scamming and acting like other people. Mm-hmm. And I can never think to do that.
We had to work for ours.
Yeah, I can never think to do that.
Yeah,
we sent tens of review copy requests before getting one.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to do with a smaller channel, which, I mean, that makes sense, because, like, why would you... Like, as a game developer, like, if I give everybody a fucking key, then I'm not going to have anything to really do, but...
Well, as a quick tip, if people are wanting to do that with their channels or get a review copy for something, it's very important to provide accurate numbers, but you want to come up with what is it that you're going to be doing with the game specifically. Like, I'm going to make a first impressions. I'm going to stream it on my channel. Here's my channel. You want to check it out. Here's an example of something I've done in the past. Mm-hmm. And you give them all that information right up front. And then, you provide them with the information and then they'll give you the response if that's something that they're interested in. And, I mean, a lot of smaller indie game companies are willing to take any amount of legitimate, real, offers to do that type of stuff if they're trying to get something get a buzz about their game.
Actually, I just had to deal with that not too long ago. Yesterday, I did I was on some Facebook group about video games, and some guy posted
the vineyard.
Game. The vineyard. Yeah, the old Facebook vineyard of video games. He posted it's from Dogwood Interactive or something like that, and I... Basically, a bunch of people were shitting on his game because it was made in RPG Maker.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
But it sounded legitimately interesting. I wanted to play. I'm like, hey, I was just going to download the demo from their website. Mm-hmm. And I was like, but it didn't work. The link didn't work. So I talked to him. Like, hey, I want to stream your game because I just want to play a game Saturday night. And I was just wondering if I could just get a demo thing or whatever. And he's like, yeah, no, absolutely. You can do that. I will host your channel. I will do all this.
Yeah.
I will do that. And just let me know when you stream. I'm like, oh, okay.
I'm making connections. We're in the industry now, boys.
Well, there's more to the story.
Oh, shit. I spoke too soon.
Yeah. I messaged him back like a half hour before I streamed last night. I'm like, hey, I'm going to stream here about half hour if you want to send people over or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I finally play the game. Like, nobody's on the stream whatsoever. Like, mm-hmm. like less numbers than I normally get anyways. Nobody's ever hosted it, nothing. And the game itself was just... Like, the demo for... Like, it seemed like a solid game. I just think they probably should have done something different with the demo because it sets you, like, right in the middle of the game.
Mm-hmm.
Where basically you have to... If you want to, like, read a backstory, you have to, like, check out the website and stuff.
That's dumb.
Yeah.
They should give you the foundation in the demo, and that way you're intrigued.
I mean, other games have done that whole start you in the middle of the game thing before, but they'll do, like, a special version of the game that still kind of glosses over it, at least.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think this kind of, like, gets to that point because basically it's you're trying to get to the top of some building and a construction guy won't let you in, so you had to go talk to one person and then you had to go talk to another person in the middle of the city.
Games like that. Where they're just like, go do this and then talk to this person.
That little random fetch quest. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even have a problem with that. It's just to get to those areas, you don't have like random battle fights to build up your character. So I was just like, I kept losing. Like, what am I doing wrong?
Yeah.
Well, if you play the game, like the first thing you see to your right hand side is a chest and you open it up. It's a weapon they use for testing, which basically gives you max stats.
Wow.
So after like dying like a few times and I understand, I'm like, well, I guess I'll just fucking just go blow right through this.
It seems like a very poorly thought out demo.
Yeah.
I want to see if they have anything. Like, I want to wait for the game to come out and, like, maybe hopefully they come out with a different demo or something because the lore seems kind of interesting, but it's just the game itself when I played it was just like, what do? I don't understand. I don't know.
Yeah, you should update us on that and see if there's anything additional that happens.
If they got a trailer, we'll trailer digest that shit.
We will trailer digest that shit. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I can send you the trailer. But, yeah, he still hasn't messaged me back or anything, so I'm just wondering if he got busy with shit or whatever. But
he's probably like, man, our demo fucking sucks.
He's probably like, oh, shit, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God.
Yeah, that's kind of shitty, though, that he didn't like, do any of the stuff that he said he was going to do or anything like that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm not going to assume that it was out of any kind of malice. It's just that, like, you couldn't even...
Oh, yeah, it might, like, shit probably just happens. You know, it's not a huge deal. It's just kind of like, well, you said you were going to do this. Why didn't you fucking... Yeah. Why didn't you do that?
Because we've gotten with some ones that we did in the past, people would retweet our channel and stuff like that when we would go live for something or when a video would be uploaded, and that's always like a really good system to do because you're getting kind of cross exposure and allowing people to see the game and see it in action is always good for developers. So
yeah. Well, let's move on because we're already half hour in. We were only on the first topic. Holy shit!
Let's get through this. So you were going to tell us about some of the Nintendo Direct events and announcements.
Oh yeah. From what I could tell, it's just basically a bunch of new games are coming out for the 3DS and a couple games for the Switch. I mean, for the 3DS games, could come out with an RPG for your Miis if people still use their Miis or whatever.
I will never understand that.
the Mii thing?
Yeah.
Is it called Mii RPG?
It's called Miitopia.
Really? They didn't call it Mii RPG? It rhymes? What?
I guess not. They didn't really think about it too hard.
Mm-hmm.
But let me look at my notes here. Let's see. Oh, yeah, ARMS. It looks really cool. I actually kind of was pretty intrigued by it because it seems like pretty legitimate, but... It also looks kind of like it could be a really messy game if it's not. Gameplay is kind of like
worried about the controls they're going to use because if you have to use those like little like thingies like the little
the Joy-Cons.
Shit, yeah. Then how like you can't? That doesn't seem feasible.
Like, yeah,
that doesn't seem like that would be very intelligent.
Yeah, that's my only concern about it. Like, it looks pretty legitimate. Like, oh, that's kind of cool. That each character has their weaknesses, and you can kind of customize what weapons you use, which arms you can use. It's just, like you said, it's kind of, I'm just kind of worried about the controls.
Yeah. Like, if they have it on, like, a regular pro controller, I guess that'll be fine.
Yeah, that'd probably be, I mean, that's what everybody would probably end up doing eventually.
Mm-hmm.
See, so arms looks kind of cool, but we'll see how that goes. And Sonic Forces, which is basically that, they're basically coming out with a new game. I think it was called, like, Sonic Collections or something a couple years ago, where they had, like, the new 3D Sonic, and you can also play with the 2D Sonic.
Yeah.
I can't remember what it was called a few years ago, but they're bringing that back.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're bringing that back for Sonic Forces, which is basically like, oh no, Eggman's destroying the world, and then you gotta play with both Sonics.
Mm-hmm.
And like the last 3 seconds of the video is like, and also there's a new character that's gonna show up, and it looks like a cat character.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if anybody's ever played this game, but it kind of looks like Bubsy to me.
Bubsy, what's that from?
It's from like the old Sega games. Let me try to find that real quick.
Are the games called Bubsy?
Yeah, that's the name of the character. Yeah, so let's see. Video game series, blah 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 blah. Yeah, there's been a bunch of them since 1990. Oh, apparently a lot of people are saying that he might be in Sonic Forces. Okay.
Okay. Well, oh, there you go. Confirmation. Man, your brain just,
yeah, you connected the dots like.
Well, I'm just really confused.
Code. Is it Bubsy?
Well, I'm just really confused why they're fucking bringing back Bubsy. I don't like, he was all right, but he could have just let him be. It's okay.
Let him die.
He's like that guy at E3. He's like, oh, Peggle 2.
Peggle.
No one gives a shit.
Whoa, that link, bro.
Yeah, apparently that got broken. Oh, boy. I'm just basically putting a link for the image search for Bubsy.
I want to say that maybe I've once seen, I mean, yeah, the character looks familiar. I never knew what he was from, though.
Yeah, it's very peculiar, especially if they are going to bring in Bubsy.
Well, I feel like what they're doing is they did this with Smash 4. They brought back some characters from older games like Little Mac and Rob, although Rob wasn't specifically Smash 4. He came back in a previous game. But they're bringing back all these older characters as like a callback. So I think what they're trying to do is mine their old.
Well, what I think there is they're gauging interest.
That's true.
They're like, oh, maybe, yeah. If people really give a shit about Bubsy and Sonic, then maybe they'll buy a Bubsy game.
Yeah,
but they, well, that's true. I guess maybe that's mine.
Maybe that's what they were doing with the previous 3D Sonic and 2D Sonic game, because they had pretty good reviews, if I remember right. They're like, oh yeah, this is fucking awesome, and so maybe they're just trying like, oh, let's reach out a little bit further. Let's get somebody else. Let's bring in fucking Bubsy.
Mm-hmm.
But that's my only confusion about that. I mean, other than that, it looks like another Sonic game. So.
Yeah.
Woohoo.
Yeah.
I don't care.
I mean, I like Sonic Hedgehog 2, but that's it.
Yeah, it's like meh. And let's see. They're bringing Payday 2 to the Switch, which, why?
Yeah.
I guess. I don't, like, I mean, like,
are the graphics going to be comparable? Is it going to have good connectivity over the internet?
I mean, it looks pretty good. It looks like Payday 2. It looks pretty solid. It's just, I thought that was dying out. I know the PC version.
They had
a lot
of controversy about all their bullshit that they were doing. With
like what?
Like their DLC, their updates were real bad.
Yeah.
They had like, I think it was, they came out on the PS4, and they just didn't update the game at all. It was like completely broken.
Oh Jesus!
And people couldn't play. They couldn't do anything, and then they just never talk about it.
Yeah. And then, I know they come out with like new DLC for the PC version like every month, it seems like.
Yeah, there's a bunch. Yeah, it they like nickel and dime you when it comes to DMC. It didn't DMC it, DLC.
The devil may cry.
I think I might cry, Jesus.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've never played a Payday, and when they pulled all that shit like 2 years ago, I was like, eh.
Like we literally were talking about, oh yeah, we should play this, and then they're like, well, maybe not.
I have ethics.
Well, why don't they just come out with Payday 3?
Because no one would buy it. Yeah. I don't think anybody. I think they've eroded their goodwill.
I think that's the only way that they can increase their consumer goodwill is come out with a better product as a third installation and stop fucking around with this bullshit.
Something new, at least. Jesus.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I was like, oh, cool, Payday 2? That's okay, I guess.
Yeah.
And then last but not least, Splatoon 2. Splatoon 2 is coming for it, and it's going to have a horde mode where you have to fight waves of weird fish monsters.
So if you ever have friends who just aren't very good at the actual multiplayer, you can have fun with them still.
Yeah, you can play with yeah. Little Finger says, whoa, that's some anger from Spence.
Well, come on. For
Spence,
real.
You gotta calm down. You're freaking lifting her out. You're scaring the child.
It just makes more sense. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, I mean, it's just been really confusing from Nintendo Direct. I'm like, why is Bubsy in this? And why is Payday 2 a thing? I don't understand. Yeah. But that's my my little taste of Nintendo Direct that I watch. I'm like,
Yeah, that's basically the gist that I got from it as well. Where they're just like, oh, we're going to come up with all these games for the Switch. But also, you know, the two main ones of the focus are ARMS and Splatoon 2.
Yeah, it's basically just ARMS and Splatoon 2. And, oh, also this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, oh, by the way, you know, these games and shit and whatever.
Yeah. And so, and until, like, either the Switch has Smash 4 on it or a game I give a shit about, like maybe Xenoblade.
Yeah.
Or...
No, Andrew.
Just something. I don't care about Zelda. Like, I don't.
And, I mean, we could get into this, but, you know, Breath of the Wild, it's a good game, but it has a lot of annoying features that makes it really hard to, like, continue to play and enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking to you, durability.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
We should bring that in for another thing, because I haven't played it at all, and I just keep hearing nothing but good things about it. So it's interesting to hear people say, like, they want to shit on it.
Dude, you should watch Jim Sterling's or his review. He gave it a 7 out of 10, and people were so fucking pissed that they DDoSed his site. They tried to hack into all of his shit. He gave it a 7.
That's positive.
I would give that shit a 7.
Yeah.
As of right now, I played like 10 hours maybe?
Yeah.
Maybe less?
Yeah. Well, and you played enough of the game to be able to give a legitimate opinion.
Yeah, opinion. And I'm just like, this is... It's fun. It's good. Mm. But this durability shit holds it back. The frame rate makes you want to eviscerate your eyes.
Although they did release an update that does fix that somewhat.
So
they are trying.
Yeah. So until the Switch has a bunch of, like, not even a bunch, but a few good first-party games or even third-party games, I'll buy the Switch. And as soon as they come out with Smash, then we'll buy the Switch.
We'll have a pre-order, buy super special Smash
Edition.
Although,
to be honest, it would be really hard to sell me on just getting another copy of the same game unless they provide it.
None of that stuff carries over.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, you know, they need to give me something when they do that, like characters, something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, wouldn't that be Amiibos?
Don't ever talk to me about Amiibos.
They have the Amiibos already.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's Nintendo Direct in a nutshell. It's just mostly confusing. That's all I have about it. You played some Bayonetta?
Do we want to do the tips?
Yeah, let's do the tips real quick because we're getting...
We're
running over quite a bit as it is, and we want to make sure to get the tips in there for people who want to be doing their own Let's Play channels. And, you know, we're not the biggest channel in the world, but we have been around the block. So
you have been around the block.
We've pretty much done the research for you.
Yeah. So, Matt, you want to start us off? We're doing SEO tips.
Yeah, so SEO is basically stands for search engine optimization. And what you want to do is you want to fill up all of your shit with as many keywords and important words that have the whatever you're doing in the title or whatever.
Yeah, so you know, basically any phrases or specific words that directly correlate with what the video is about.
Mm-hmm. And then when you're recording a video, you want to make sure that the file name is the same as the title of the video that's going to go on YouTube. So you want those to be the same.
Yeah,
I did not know that.
Yeah, you don't want to name the video that you record and have on your computer like, you know, like for example. I don't know, Super Metroid number 2, and then name the one like Super Metroid, you know, and then you have like a funny line about what it's about, and then number 2, or anything of that sort, or you want it to be uniform, So when it goes on YouTube,
they take that into account. They take the file name into account.
Yeah.
And that kind of bumps you up a little bit on the search rankings. So when people search those videos, your videos will pop up.
Yeah.
Also, you want to fill out, you have 5,000 characters in the YouTube description. Might be 10,000, but I'm pretty sure it's 5,000.
It sounds right.
I think it's 5,000.
Yeah. You want to fill that.
As much as possible.
Fill that as much as possible. So, Livinger asks, what's a good file name? So, say you're playing Super Metroid, and you're like, you're recording an episode. You want that name to be the same as the title on the video. So, you would name that file Super Metroid, dash, big boss fight, then either dash or the line straight down. What is that called?
I don't know, but when you do shift and you do the backspace, or not backspace, but backslash on the computer, it does like a straight up and down line.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a good like separator, and then you can put the episode number. But yeah, actually, that's a good question, because you want to have the game, like the name of the game that you're playing, to be the first thing
in
the file name and the title of the video, because everything reads from left to right. So it has the most priority when it's the farthest to the left.
Yeah.
So that's why I haven't been getting views, is because I haven't been using the file name thing. That's it. All right. Mystery solved.
That amongst some other stuff, because this rule applies to everything else that you do as well. So information inside of the description and your tags and the file name and the title of the video, you need to have the same words in all of those, because the more instances of that word you have, the more searchability it has, because
you'll ping more.
You'll ping more when someone searches that.
Hmm. Yeah. And so you have 5,000 characters that you can use in the YouTube description. You want to fill that all the way up. You can have like a little blurb at the top going, thank you. Thanks for watching my video. Like if you want. And then whatever. But you want to fill that up.
So yeah.
And when you fill it up.
Okay, I got you.
Do not put your tags in the description, not the raw tags. So on YouTube you can tag stuff, so you'd be like Super Metroid blah 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 blah, and you're tagging that stuff. Do not put those tags like
in the description. Not only is it tacky,
they have to form sentences, like they have to be coherent basically.
Yeah.
Or YouTube will ban your punk ass.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's against their terms of service. So,
because people, what they would do is they would just basically get a huge string of words,
keywords,
like separated by commas, which is how you put them inside of the tags. You can have a notepad file, have all your tags in there, and just have all of your phrases or keywords separated by commas, and you just copy and paste that into YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And in the tag section, it'll automatically separate the tags out the way it's supposed to be. But people used to just fill their descriptions full of just a bunch of random words.
Yeah, random tags.
They would put a big no-no is if you're playing a game that you know another big YouTuber's playing, people would put...
That
YouTuber's name in their tags. Make sure that doesn't happen.
Make sure all your tags are relevant to your video.
Yeah.
Okay? Mm. Like, if you talk about Total Biscuit in your video, then you can probably put Total Biscuit in the tags and in the... Just in the tags. Well, I wouldn't even put that shit in the description.
Yeah, yeah. For instance, for episode 2 of our podcast, I did include Total Biscuit, G2A, and Gearbox as part of the tags.
Because those are major focal points of the video.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's basically how you should be doing it. So the file name should be the same as the YouTube title. Description should be maxed, and tags should be maxed. Maxed.
Yeah, and your tags and the somewhere in your description, somewhere in your tags, you should try to replicate any of the keywords or phrases that you include in your title, so that you have those multiple instances.
Yeah,
and as far as tags are concerned, there's a couple ways you can go about it, because I do basically all the tags for videos. Matt knows all the same stuff as I do, but. You want to include the words by themselves. So say we're talking about Gearbox versus G2A, or G2A versus Gearbox, whatever. You would want to put Gearbox, G2A, and then G2A versus Gearbox, and G2A versus Gearbox being its own tag because people will search phrases. So yeah. They'll do, or if it's for Super Metroid, you can do Super Metroid and then Metroid maybe.
And then Super.
Yeah, and then Super, and then do Super Metroid gameplay as a tag, or Super Metroid Let's Play as a tag. If people are searching that, you'll get the tag, the ping on the Super, on the Metroid, on the Super Metroid, and on the Super Metroid gameplay, if that's what they're searching. So you get all of that. Now, be forewarned, if you're doing something like gameplay as a tag, you're not going to get all of your, you know, a bunch of people because of that specific tag, because everybody has that in their tags. But it's kind
doesn't
of...
doesn't hurt to put it in
it, but it doesn't hurt, so include it, definitely. Gotcha.
And that's pretty much the SEO or SEO tips.
Yeah, and that's
nice.
That's how you do it.
It's just as easy as 1, 2, 3.
It's really a lot harder
to look up information.
To look up information about it, because no one says it as clearly as I have stated it for you.
Yeah, I think people like to keep it an industry secret in some ways, but really that's all there is to it, is just repetition and, you know, like we said about the title, make sure that the name of the game is first. You don't want to put the name of your channel first.
We don't
first.
Have to...
Well, no, but I wanted to include, don't put the name of your channel first, because that's not going to get you anything. Mm-hmm.
But oh, and the tags are in the title.
In the title.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But you do want to include your channel in the tags, because if people start searching for you specifically, that'll help it out.
Hmm. Cool. Well, that's a very helpful tip. That's something I learned. I did not know about the keeping your file name the same as your title.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's something that it's not even like something that's in most lists of stuff.
Yeah.
Hmm. Good call on that.
Yeah.
I was kind of confused. I don't know who that is. It's like, what?
Yeah.
Why do you?
All right. So we can move on. Matt, you played some Bayonetta. Well, you played some Bayonetta and you have some information about the PC port.
Yes. One second. Let me. How the fuck do you spell Bayonetta? Bayonetta.
Bayobetta.
Bayobettas.
Bayobetta. Bayobetta.
Is that right?
Yeah. You just have the S there, so it looks weird.
My bad. Okay.
Cool.
Bayonetta released on the PC on April 11th, and it's super good.
Yeah.
It's made by Platinum, and they do all the really good Spectacle Fighters. Like, second, let me just look it up. They've done Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, Transformers Devastation, and The Legend of Korra. That wasn't that good.
Yeah.
But it was still... It was done by their B team, basically.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
And these are just the games that are actually on Steam. So all those games are on Steam.
Oh,
And the interesting about this is that... is this the first PC port of Bayonetta?
Yeah. This is the first... Before it was console exclusive.
And it runs well. It runs good.
So what's crazy about this is that they released this port or whatever, and it has more options, is cheaper, and is a better game than Bulletstorm Full Clip. And
people were talking about that. Bulletstorm Full Clip, which is the newer updated version of it, is actually missing options from the original version.
Like, weird.
Yeah.
If you wanted to look at how to do a port right, look at Bayonetta. All the controls...
And that's an older game.
Everything is very solid.
Unfortunately, Bayonetta 2 is not on PC, and it's not likely to be because that was released on the Wii U.
Yeah, and Nintendo owns the rights to that. And I don't think they've ever released a PC game. So.
No, I don't think so, yeah.
Sonic PC.
Which that
kind
of sucks. Yeah.
Yeah. But I do recommend buying Bayonetta. And even if you're not even sure if you're going to play it, you should buy it. So that way we get more ports
successfully done.
Good games that were console exclusive.
Yeah.
This shows an interest that there's a market that people will buy this shit.
Yeah.
And you should buy it.
Yeah, this
it's
is
only $20.
All the shit.
Yeah, it is actually it's a really good price for a port, because there have been ports in the past of older games where they just release it at what would be considered full price nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that we would definitely say is not something you should do. Wait for a sale if you want to get one of those games. But this one, it's a good price, and the game is well optimized. It runs well. I didn't even realize that this is something that was released as a port on the PC when I was playing it. I didn't know that at first, And I thought that it was like being run through an emulator or something, or it was, but no, it's fully integrated.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. Cause even like Boldstorm, the full clip thing, that's a full $60 too. Cause they, so I didn't realize Bayonetta was only $20.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I might have to go pick it up.
Yeah. It's super good. There are some things that are odd about it. It's very, it's made by the same guy who did Devil May Cry.
In general, it's a very odd game, art-wise and like direction-wise, but
some of the design decisions. One second, I have Bayonetta. I thought I had Bayonetta up. Some of the design decisions are very 2009.
Matt looked it up just so we could get the year, so we can make that.
So you have like random QTEs like in the middle of cutscenes. Uh-huh. And you're like,
keeps you on your toes.
I had no idea that this was interactive. So then you die, and then obviously these are all score-based games, whatever. You get like...
Yeah, each mission, each chapter is like a mission, and you have like a score for how well you did throughout the whole thing.
Yeah. So they kind of throw really weird random QTEs in your face.
And there's a lot of portions of the game where it kind of changes the entire... like type of gameplay. Like there's
they had that one portion.
Yeah.
Before that, they didn't have anything.
Okay.
Like that.
Yeah. See, I didn't see a whole bunch of the game, but there is a chapter of the game that actually
it's like an on rails, what are they called? Shmups.
Shmup. Yeah, shoot 'em up game where you're flying.
Yeah, where you're flying.
You're literally on a missile shooting people, shooting like mechs that are coming at you and stuff.
It's
and
like
dragons.
Galaga.
Nice.
That lasted like an hour.
Oh, it is actually hard. It is a hard. You have to learn all of these mechanics for just this one section, and you and by the end you're good at it, and then that's the end of the. It's not anywhere else in the game,
but
so far. But
yeah,
it's a good piece of
work. Good. I've heard good things about it. I didn't realize it was actually only $20. That's pretty good for a full fledged game.
Yeah, a full fledged PC port where. I'm sure if they were still selling it on the system, it would probably still be at $60.
No, it wouldn't.
You don't think so?
No, not at all.
I guess
it's just plain wrong.
Well, okay, that's true. There are some game developers where no matter what, their games will always be at like full price.
Like Activision.
Activision and stuff like that. So that's where I was getting that from. But I shouldn't copy and paste previous things about other companies onto this company. So. Yeah,
that's bad SEO, Spencer. What are you doing?
That's true.
Yeah,
that's true. It's different information. But we can move on to we're gonna run over our time limit for our podcast here. But we do have some more information, and we can kind of decide whether or not we want to talk about these other points. But I wanted to bring up the new game that came out called Yooka-Laylee, which is a 3D platformer. Kind of collectathon style game, much like Banjo-Kazooie. It is, I guess, what this particular company is trying to do is bring back an interest or revive that particular genre because it's basically died. I remember PlayStation 1, that was the type of game that was just it. You had Spyro, you had Banjo-Kazooie, you had all these kind of slightly open worldish. Collectible games where you fight these monsters, but it's not like really fighting, you know. These kind of adventure games that came out, and the information so far that has come out about it and the reviews, very mixed, middle of the road reviews. Apparently, in trying to bring back the feeling of the original 3D platformers such as Banjo-Kazooie, which people are saying it basically is Banjo-Kazooie, just. It came out in 2017 instead.
Yeah.
is that they really missed the mark. They,
they've taken no modern like ideas of gaming.
Yeah, they didn't play anything new.
They didn't like evolve the series.
No,
it's like
they
literally made the game back in 1998 or whatever Banjo-Kazooie was.
Yeah, and not only did they not evolve the particular genre of game, they didn't even do the existing genre very well, apparently.
Yeah.
A lot of the levels, many people in their reviews have opinions that are almost exactly the same when it comes to the fact that the levels are uninteresting. They are not really as open or as or as engaging as a lot of the older games, and none of them really stick with you. There's no real charm to any of it, and it really seems kind of like a phoned-in version of what Banjo-Kazooie used to be. So it's kind of sad to see because I really want a Yooka-Laylee to do well. I wasn't interested in it at all, but there's a game coming out being made by an indie developing company called A Hat in Time that mm-hmm. is a 3D platforming game that does look like it's bringing some new stuff to the genre and looks actually really, really good. And it's been in development for 4 or 5 years now, and I've been following it for about 4 years, mm-hmm. just checking in on it and stuff like that. And they're almost to release this year, and I really hope that either this doesn't hurt the genre as a whole and hurt people's initial expectations going to the game, or hopefully people will look at it and be like, oh, this is actually a good example of how to do the game. And I've seen many demos of what the levels look like. If you look up A Hat in Time on YouTube, or if you just go to their page, they have a YouTube channel where they have trailers for each of the chapters as they've kind of come out with them to give you an idea about what the theme for that particular level is, because it deals with time travel, so you go through different time periods. And it just seems like they put a lot of like love and actual thought into how to make each level unique and really build it on top of older games like Banjo-Kazooie, instead of we're going to make Banjo-Kazooie but newer and then just kind of like not make it good.
Yeah.
But the good things about the game, you know, I haven't played it myself, so I can't really tell you whether or not you should go get it. But
I hear the PC port is not very good.
Yeah, the PC port's not very good, but if you get the console version, the gameplay, as far as controllability, seems fine. It doesn't seem to be any particular issues with actually playing the game, game mechanics wise. It just kind of comes across as an uninspired
clone
addition to that particular genre, unfortunately. So that's the world's opinion of Yooka-Laylee as it is right now. Middle of the road, kind of a 50% kind of deal.
Jim Sterling gave it a 2.
Yep.
And people DDoSed his site.
Again.
There are people who were in love with Banjo-Kazooie and can look past all of that. Apparently, it's still really funny. It has a lot of like the classic types of lines.
The puns and stuff,
vocals.
Yeah.
Yeah, the vocals and puns and stuff like that.
Put a bullet in my fucking temple.
And one example of kind of one of the mechanics that could have been done without, that was included because they were just trying to go so hard with it, is there's a mechanic where you, to complete each section, you have to answer a bunch of quiz questions.
Where boss fights would usually be.
Yeah, where boss fights would usually be. You have to basically just pass a quiz. And I don't know what the questions necessarily are about. The guy that I was reading from or watching from didn't really go into that, but I can only assume it has to do with like the level or something. But the quiz questions, apparently it doesn't do anything to add to the gameplay. It just kind of serves to
Jim Sterling was saying that it was a lot of weird, obscure, kind of stupid shit that you don't really pay attention to.
Oh,
that's in the quiz.
Oh, so it's like how many apple figurines were in the courtyard of the main area of this particular level.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, 2. We're like, nope, it was 3. There was one behind the bush, I'm assuming. But yeah, so that's the world's opinion of Yooka-Laylee. And hopefully it doesn't...
I wouldn't really say the world's opinion.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know why I'm saying that, but some reviews have thought of it that way, and it seems to be...
The more critical reviews are saying that.
Yeah.
A lot of hardcore fans are loving it. They think it's great.
Yeah. And I've been trying to get that across, but it's been kind of hard because I've been basically...
You have not
basically,
gotten that across.
Yeah.
I have now gotten that across for you.
Thank you.
I just put that over.
That's true. You did put that over.
Okay.
Yeah, I wasn't trying to be overcritical of the game necessarily.
I don't give a shit about the game.
Well, most of the information I heard was just the critical information.
Yeah.
So
that's what I'm interested in. Like, if it was good, then I would have played it. Mm-hmm. But I was never... I like better games like Jack and Daxter and Sly Cooper.
Well, I was hoping that it would be up to that level because although I'm not a huge fan of those types of games, I know that you really enjoy them, and I was hoping to be able to make content of some type about it and kind of go down memory lane a little bit, but also have like a really good game on top of it, which is why I'm so interested in A Hat in Time because...
Yeah, I think The Hat in Time will be much better.
Yeah, it looks really, really good. But, perfect timing. Oh, just...
Oh.
Just perfect timing. We were just done talking. We ran out of things to say right at the moment you came back. It's so great. Sorry. So we have a little bit of time here.
So we want to end the episode, or do we want to go into the de novo stuff?
We could save it for next episode. Actually, because it's mostly topics that you guys were kind of specializing in anyways, you could save it for next week's episode since I'll be gone.
I agree.
That's true.
Yeah, because you guys could probably talk for years on that, on all this stuff. So
yeah, I guess the one thing I wanted to add, which is one of our topics, but it's something that doesn't require too much to say, really, more of like an announcement. It goes in with the Nintendo Direct and the announcements there, is the fact that Nintendo is canceling their production of the Nintendo Classic, which is the... Basically, they're only canceling it in North America. So Europe and Japan are still going to get the Nintendo Classic, which is something I didn't realize until somewhat recently. But it's one of those things where they just can't keep up with the demand, and it was only supposed to be a limited run anyways. And so now it's going to be even, basically, this last shipment, that's it. No more Nintendo Classic. It's not going to be available in North America anymore. So.
Which you can, and it's not a huge, I mean, I don't think that's really a huge deal because you can hire.
That's why that's why I just wanted to kind of tack this on at the end, because it didn't seem like a topic that we would really care about.
I just meant like anybody can like have somebody make it with a Raspberry Pi or something real quick.
Yeah, that was most people's opinions of that.
Yeah, it's like, oh no, I can't get it. I guess I'll just buy a $5 or however cheap it is and build that real
and
quick.
And just load it full of ROMs for the emulators. But yeah, let's go ahead and pimp out our channels here. So you first, Super Fist Cake. Tell us about yourself.
All righty. I am Super Fist Cake on, what is it? Yeah, my YouTube and my Twitter, which I'm always tweeting. I'm not YouTubing as much. I'm trying to get back into it, but I've been dealing with technical issues with my streams and stuff and recently. So once I get that figured out, I will update more on my YouTube. But I will be doing a... I guess I won't be doing a video game in 5 minutes. So never mind about all that. But you can see me in the future, though. I will probably do a video game in 5 minutes, which is my little baby that I dropped off at the fire station a few years ago, and I'm now coming back to pick it up.
It's matured a little bit.
And now that it's not crying all the damn time, it's just like, oh, just, come on, man. God, stop the crying. God.
Yeah, if you're interested, he does have a video game in 5 minutes that you can watch for Shadow of Mordor.
Yeah, in case you didn't play it and you're wondering what the deal is with Shadow of War, you can check out the prequel. Well, not really prequel. The before
game. The first one.
Yeah.
The first one, Shadow of Mordor, which, yeah, it's only 5 minutes long. I mean, everybody's got 5 minutes. Shit.
Exactly. That's the main selling point, man.
Yeah. But also, I stream Monday, Wednesday, Friday, not this Friday. I won't be able to do it this Friday because I will be in Chicago for C2E2. No lifting. I don't have a crying baby. I just have two dogs. One of them kind of cries a little bit. It's mostly annoying.
Basically
but
a crying baby. Let's be real here.
Basically a giant hairy baby.
But mentioning the fact that you're going to be at C2E2 next weekend, which if you want to know about how that goes, you know, definitely follow Super Fistcake's Twitter account, Super Fistcake. But next week we are going to be without the great Super Fistcake. His ascension will be complete for a short period of time, in which case we might have a guest possibly on next week's edition. Of the Content Complete podcast.
Did you talk to that one guest that you were thinking about talking to yet or not?
I have not, and that's because I suck as a person, but I will.
Okay. I was just wondering if you talked to them or not yet, but okay, yeah. Oh, I'll be gone this Friday. I won't be here. I'll be doing C2E2. Like Spencer said, I will definitely tweet. I might do videos. I'm not for sure. It's just kind of cool. I've never been to like a convention before, so I'm pretty excited about it. And I'm going to meet David Hayter, who is the voice actor for the original Solid Snake in the first 3-4 Metal Gear Solid games. So
nice.
I'm going to probably shit myself a lot, and that's going to be okay.
You should document the experience.
I don't know if I want people to see me cry like a giant baby, so I don't know. We'll see, though.
We already know your opinion of crying babies.
Yeah.
Drop them off at the station.
Drop me off at the station. I'm fucking worthless. Oh, God.
Oh, hey, Charlie. What's going on? Speaking of crying babies,
Oh boy. But that's it for me. What do you guys do?
We do Super Smash Brothers. But no, on a more serious note, again, we are going to be ending our Super Smash Brothers Project M series at episode 600. The currently uploaded, I think there's probably maybe 3 weeks or more left until that's done. But beyond that, we do content for Melee. We're going to pick up again content for Smash 4. We currently have a series of Hollow Knight that we have more episodes coming out this week, so we're going to try to continue that as long as we feel like it's necessary. And if you're interested in that particular game and just kind of hanging out with us for that, definitely check that out.
Except for like the first three episodes of this coming up week, I play like absolute like horse shit.
I think it's still like entertaining.
Oh yeah, it's super fun. It was fun to play.
Loved it every second of it.
Every second of it, I was like, yeah, I'm having a great fucking time.
but beyond that, I mean, we have some other things in the works that we want to kind of bring back. We used to have this old series called The Trailer Digest, where we would watch a trailer and then basically watch it for the first time and react to it live. Mm-hmm. So that's something that we want to bring back because we always like doing that. It's super quick. It's only as long as the trailer ends up being, so about 4 minutes or so, those episodes. That's basically us. Follow our YouTube channel, the NFL Gaming TV. If you're not watching this on stream, you can definitely check the entire Content Complete podcast stream at twitch.tv/NFL Gaming TV at 5 p.m. Central or 3 p.m. Pacific on Sundays, which is the day that we're currently recording this now. And if you want more information about what we're doing or if you want to follow us on Twitter, definitely do that as well. Neanderthal GTV. But I think that's it.
Also, the audio version of the podcast can be found on all your favorite podcasting platforms, Spotify, iTunes, other shit.
Thanks to our great other
ascended
half.
Brother.
Super Fist Cake. He puts all that together for us. And I'm currently subscribed to the iTunes version of it and the SoundCloud version of it. And the quality is good and it feels just like every other podcast. So I'm actually pretty happy about that. It's nice.
I do my best. I'm trying to make it a good podcast. A very spicy meatball.
Spicy pasta. It's a me, a Mario.
But yeah, thank you, Littlefinger. I will definitely have a good time at C2E2, and I cannot wait to hang out with David Hayter.
Going to be awesome.
It's going to be a good time for everybody.
All right. Well, that about wraps it up.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for tuning in and for watching on any of the platforms that you currently are catching us on. But we'll see you guys next time.
Peace.
Bye. Play it.